Snatchin'.
Like a lot of times, little ditties will come out of just messing around on something, and that phrase had come up.
Some of the writing happened on stage, I remember. Mm-hmm. I would say more arranging.
Right.
It's just really jazzy, but when I would play it, I would try to play in the style that my dad, and sometimes you hear the Fairfield Four and those old gospel singers singing in this style where they're singing, whoop, whoop,
Golden Gate Quartet. Whoop.
You know, and they call it snatching. And my dad said, you know, y'all ready to go snatch one? When I play it, I'm actually thinking of that style of singing where they're snatching.
You use an envelope filter on it?
No, using the harmonizer.
Harmonizer,
that one.
Yeah.
Oh, right. Sounds like there's multiple saxes, but right. They aren't. It's all done with effects with the original live sax, which is cool. I thought it was kind of like a police song. I mean, the way the bridge is, bam, 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 bam. To me, I thought I was imagining myself to be a poor man's Andy Summers.
I never heard it that way, but I can see it now.
Well, on that part, yeah, and then it comes back to the tight.
Yeah. One of the things I like when you guys are constructing a funky rhythm part is a lot of times instead of having it all be full, you'll just leave an empty spot. And you did that in some places on that.
Yeah.
I really like that. It's like playing the space. Uh-huh. It's as powerful as a hit would be. It's a reverse hit.
Exactly. It's like the zero.
Actually playing the rest.
Yeah,
that's a lot of times the key to funk is where the spaces are.
Key to money, too. You know, you add more zeros, get more stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Reminiscence. You've been playing that one for a while, haven't you?
Yeah, became known as a song that I usually detune my bass on when I play it solo. I don't know when I started playing it. Just another one of those songs that I would play around at soundcheck, and then you would say, well, we should learn it. And so we did. I had a bunch of different parts. I never really heard it with other instruments. It's just always been a solo bass song. Yeah. And I usually do a thing where I just detune my bass in the middle of it. Actually had quite a few parts to the song that I had never really learned to play. I just knew what they were, but we fleshed them out. Some of them I still don't remember how some of those chords move around. I remember I played it in New York one time for Bass Day, a big bass concert, and it was right after the 9/11 incident, and I did it as a tribute. And I explained it to the people how, you know, 9/11 was my birthday, and I remember Bela waking me up that morning telling me to come look at the TV. The way I do it as a solo piece anyway, with the kind of destruction of the bass, kind of was reminiscent of that day, you know. Kind of started out peaceful, I thought anyway. I was waking up, it was birthday, then you get to the TV, you see buildings falling, planes flying and everything, you know. But I chose to end the tune back peaceful again. Hopefully that's where all this will end up. But it was nice playing it with the band, because we do it without the whole breakdown in the middle.
First time you did that with the band, remember when that was?
With the Flecktones.
I was scared out of my gourd, because it was a big gig.
Mm-hmm.
It was at the Beacon Theater, I think the first time played there. So all of a sudden, he starts untuning the bass, you know? We were like the fourth song into the show. He just started tearing the bass apart. And I was thinking, he is never going to get out of this thing.
But it's nice, though, because that one line in the middle of that song,
it's
a really weird line. It's nice hearing the different instruments play that.
Then Pamela got on it, and it almost started to sound like a James Taylor song or something, like a prairie thing, because her theremin sounds like almost like... Yeah, that puts you out in the woods somewhere.
Yeah,
I know some.
Sleeper is a tune that I wrote, I don't know how much I want to talk about it, actually. It had to do with somebody dying. It was pretty close to me, and after the funeral, I had to catch some flights to meet the band. We had to take a ferry boat from Vancouver or Seattle to Victoria, and it was on that ferry boat that I just started whistling that melody, and I was definitely thinking about the situation that had happened with this friend. And then I taught it to you guys very soon after that. In some weird way, being on the top of this ferry boat, I just started whistling that melody and thinking about this thing. It was almost like a sea shanty or something. I didn't know what it was. It was a simple melody. I think I showed it to you guys just a couple of days later, and we started playing it. That's when I realized it was in 5/4. And it just sounded very heroic when the band started to play it just right away. How it evolved on the record into what it ended up being is really, it's just one of those things. I couldn't have planned for it to turn out the way it did. We had a long jam intro, which was great. It's like with Future Man, you always have to prod him to do a drum solo. But then when he does it, it's killer, you know, so.
That's my Carter Beauford, you know, we just hanging in the back.
Yeah. You know. As the leader, I'm always thinking about balance. I'm trying to make sure everybody's gotten to do their thing somewhere on the record. And I was thinking, God, I got to get Future Man to kick some butt on the drums on a solo somehow. So we came up with this idea of having a long intro and a long outro to this song. And, you know, we were all encouraging you to open up. You know, just feel free. Have the song start out with you, you know, rolling around on the drum set, and then it would come into this place. Which worked out great. We had lots of great stuff to choose from. Mm-hmm. But on the outro, there was one moment on one of the takes where it sounded to me like it went into 4-4 for like a measure or two. And it didn't go into 4-4 like in the right place or anything. And so after all you guys were gone one night late, I started screwing around with that take. And I made a little loop out of that 1-4-4 measure. Just multiplied it by an infinite amount, and I thought it was really cool, but I remember playing it for you. You were a little suspicious at first because it doesn't hold the five. It doesn't end up in four the right way. It just sort of ends up there by some strange fluke, which to me was why it was cool. I mean, I just thought it was cool because it seemed like it was supposed to go there. So as each person came to town and sang or played, they had to figure out a way to navigate through that section and get into this loop. And once the loop started to happen, China Doll was the thing that sent it over the edge.
Sho Hong, her name is XIU.
But didn't you guys hear her singing in the back room of a Chinese restaurant?
Jonathan introduced me to her. I said, you gotta hear her sing, so I just pulled my camera out and said, sing something. And she's not shy, she sang something. It was like, oh, I understand.
Yeah. So one day I get this call, we've got a Chinese girl singer and we're coming over. So she comes over and we're trying to figure out what to put her on. A couple days before, I had remembered that I had a melody that might work over that long loop thing. You did percussion and I did banjo, and we laid it down on top of what was there. And then Jeff came in and did a thing with his flute where he sang along with his flute. I don't know what to call that thing that you did, but it was very oriental sounding. And it was great. You know? When she came in, it was like, do you think you could sing this melody? And she's like, well, it starts very high and it goes very low. She had to go to the top of her range to hit the high notes, but it wouldn't have sounded good if she'd just done it in the same octave both times and just repeated it. Future Man said she speaks all these different dialects and she does opera, Chinese opera. And I said, well, let's
Chinese
get her to
opera.
Talk. Mm-hmm. So we got her to start speaking in Chinese, and we don't know what she said, but she went into various things and started laughing, talking, doing all this stuff. And that was really the beginning, because it was after that that Ganesh and Kumar came to town. And when they came in, we got them to do some vocal percussion. Sandeep did some stuff next, and he's the one who read some stuff from the Bhagavad Gita, I think. But now it's starting to get kind of spooky. When the chieftains were in town, well, maybe some Gaelic would be appropriate in here. You know,
is
and,
this a private fight, or can anyone join in?
So Kevin read some stuff in Gaelic, and we put it through an effect so it sounds like a whole monastery full of monks. And so now it's getting pretty wacky.
We've got the whole power of myth going.
All we don't have is an African guy, you know? And that's when Bobby McFerrin comes to town, and he starts singing. I don't know if it's really African stuff, but he just sounded like various African dialects, but it was just that sound. Then we got the Irish guys to play. Basically, everybody who was coming through town, we got them on, and it turned into quite a sea of things. Getting towards the end of the record, and we went on a trip to Hawaii. We had an opening act, a guy who played the ukulele named Jake Shimabakuru. And Jake really impressed all of us.
What a talent.
Big time.
Yeah. So I got Jake to do some recording late at night after a couple of different gigs. And one of the things that he played on was Sleeper. Just another culture to have in there, you know. It really took it all away.
World music.
Yeah.